Hello guys, welcome back. In the last video, we learned the entire concept about how compilation process takes place, and we also learned about assembly language and high level language, just the basics. Now, in this video, we will learn about the basic concepts of OS, or the operating system. So when you use your first computer, since that day till today, you are in touch with this OS. So first of all, let us understand what this OS means. Or the operating system. Now, this operating system is a collection of software that manages the computer hardware and allocates resources to various tasks that need to be performed. Your computer has a very complex hardware. Now, it is not possible for a human being to control that hardware entirely. So, it is this OS which serves the purpose for you. This OS actually acts as your assistant to manage the hardware. And what it also does is, it allocates the resources to various tasks. For example, say suppose you want to print a file, a PDF file or a document file. In order to print that file, you'll need a printer. Whenever you want to print a file, all you need to do is press the Control P button, a Control and P button together, and select OK, and the file gets printed. So how does the computer know that it is the printer from which the file needs to be printed? Well, that knowledge is given to the computer by the OS. And in a more general sense, the OS actually acts as an interface between the computer and the user. The entire hardware of the computer is completely abstracted from the user. There must be someone who can actually interact with that hardware, because after all, that is what we are interested in. Just the difference is that we are writing lines of instructions, and those instructions are getting converted into computer language, and internally, we are actually interacting with that hardware. So, this is an indirect interaction. It performs all the basic tasks like file management, memory management, process management, handling input and output, and controlling peripheral devices such as disk drives and printers. Some examples of OS or some examples of operating systems are Linux, Windows, OS X, VMX, Mac OS, and so on. What this memory management means? It is pretty obvious that your computer has ROM, your computer has RAM, your computer has cache, your computer has some registers. To perform any operation in your computer, there must be someone who manages your memory. There must be some method so that memory is allocated only as much required, and it is allocated right at the proper time or at the time when it is required. And this memory that I'm speaking about is actually your RAM, the RAM of the computer. So every process needs, or every process consumes some amount of RAM while the process is running. So that allocation of memory or that management is actually done by the operating system. It is the operating system who is responsible to allocate memory to various processes and tasks that are running in your computer. Processor management. It is not possible for a human being to understand what will be best for your underlying processor. So, the OS is programmed in such a way that it does every internal operation for you. And that is very useful in the multi-programming environment that we are in today. Because we cannot rely on such processors which perform only one task at a time. That is not at all possible in the modern day scenario. So, it is the OS who decides which process gets the processor, when and for how much time. So this is basically nothing but task scheduling. Next is device management. You connect several devices to your computer every day. You connect your USB flash disk, you connect your microphones, you connect your headsets, you connect your printers, you connect the mouse, you connect your joystick and whatnot. Now, in order to operate or in order to be able to establish communication between these external peripherals and devices with your main computer or the motherboard or rather the processor, there must be someone who can actually establish that connection. So it is the OS who does that or establishes that communication with the help of drivers. You must have heard this term about drivers, because every time when you buy a new laptop or a new computer, you need to install some drivers. Not sure about the latest computers, because the latest computers come with drivers pre-installed, but if you buy a relatively old model, then you need to install few drivers manually. So these drivers actually help the OS in order to establish that particular communication path. Now, we speak about the type of OS. There are several types of OS. Few of them are batch OS, time sharing OS, distributed OS, network OS, and real time OS. OS stands for operating system. What happens in batch OS is that in this type of operating system, the user does not interact with the computer directly. What a user does is whatever task he has to perform, he just punches that on few cards. Those are actually not exactly cards, but then we can call it as punch cards. So he prepares a job list, or he punches his tasks or instructions on those cards and hands it over to the operator who operates the computer. Now, in order to speed up this process, what the operator does is he batches together or combines those jobs together which are similar to each other. Next type of OS is time sharing OS. In this case, what is done is it actually enables many people located at various terminals to use a particular system at the same time. It is a logical extension of multiprogramming. Now, this time sharing, this concept of time sharing is nothing but it is multitasking. In today's world, you obviously have to perform multitasking, and that is only possible with the help of this time sharing OS. The process is time is divided into several slots, and those slots are provided to instructions to be able to finish the instructions within that particular time slot. If any instruction remains incomplete in that time slot, then first the instructions which are waiting in the queue are executed, and then the first instruction is again allocated some time. So that is the concept of time sharing OS. Now, before going to the next one, I would like to say that I am not going into depth of all the concepts of OS, because that you will be studying later on when you study operating systems as a subject. The next type of OS is the distributed OS. In distributed system, what happens is there are multiple CPUs or multiple processors to serve multiple real-time applications and multiple users. In this case, the task is not actually limited to a single processor. It is not the responsibility of a single processor to execute a single task completely. Instead, the task is divided into several processors and they perform that together. This kind of an OS environment is actually used in large or huge tasks, for example, data processing, because data processing can be really burdening task, and that requires high amount of processor usage. So these type of tasks are not centralized. Actually, these type of tasks are decentralized, and multiple processors together work to complete that single task. And these processors communicate with one another through various communication lines. They may be, say, telephone cables or any kind of cables, actually. In network OS, what happens is this kind of an OS runs on a server and provides the server the capability to manage data, users, groups, security, applications, and other networking functions. The primary purpose of this network operating system is to allow shared file and printer access among multiple computers in a network, typically a local area network or LAN. In this type of OS, actually, the idea is that if there is some kind some file on one particular computer, then that can be transferred directly to all the computers which are connected together to form a network. In this case, several computers are connected. In this type of an OS, what happens is several computers are connected together and they work together. And this interconnection is by means of LAN or local area network. For example, Unix, Mac OS, WinServer 2008, etc. And lastly, real-time OS. A real-time system is defined as a data processing system in which the time interval required to process and respond to inputs is so small that it controls the environment. In such an OS, actually, what happens is the time that is required to complete a particular task, it is so small that actually the time required to process the inputs is so small that it can control the entire environment. The time taken by the system to respond to an input and display of required updated information is termed as the response time. So this term response time, it is itself self-explanatory. It means that it is actually the time that is required to generate some kind of response. Now, there are two types of real-time OS. They are hard real-time systems and soft real-time system. Again speaking, I will not go into depth of OS because that you'll be studying later. In this part, we will take a look at some of the basic UNIX commands that you'll be using through this semester and maybe upcoming semesters. So the first command is to create a new directory. So the command is mkdir and dir name. This dir name is the name of the directory that you want to give. Cd dir name. What this does is it takes you from one directory to another directory. Rmdir, it will delete a directory. And in order to perform this operation, your directory must be empty. Next command is pwd. It gives you the present working directory. For example, if you are in some current folder, you are working in a folder, say folder 1. So if you type the command pwd in the terminal or your command prompt, it will give you the name of the present working directory. Now, coming to commands for files. The first command is ls. This ls command lists all the files that are present in your current working directory or the present working directory. When you attach a minus l, that is a hyphen l, not actually minus, it is a hyphen l. When you attach this hyphen l after this ls, then it lists all your files in long format. That means, long format means along with the name of the file, there are several other details that you get for that particular file. This command ls hyphen a, it lists all the files. It even lists the files whose name starts with a dot. Next is cp command. What it does is it actually copies a file. Cp filename 1, filename 2. What it does is it copies a file. So basically, it will suppose if you want to copy a file, to copy the contents of a file hello into another file, say world. So when you write cp hello space world, actually cp space hello space world, then a new file called world will be created, and the content of that particular file will be the same as the content of this first file. When you write this command mv filename 1 filename 2, it basically moves one file from one location to another location. Next is rm filename. This command deletes a file. This date command shows the current date and time. This calendar month year shows a calendar of the current month. GCC compiles C file. G++ compiles a C++ file. Thank you.